It's long since I discussed anything with you guys, particularly in the computer architecture. I didn't open up for a long time because I was on my vacation. So now it's time again for us to get into the learning mode. And this is session 4 in my computer organization and architecture learning teaching process. I'm going to tell you about the instruction execution cycle, along with we need to recap certain terms, certain terminologies. Once we do that, I think we are eligible to go into the next level, where we will understand more about MIPS, its types of instruction, and how do we build a data path components. All those things we will see little later. But this serves as predominantal, fundamental stuff for you to understand what happens. First, what is a program? A program is nothing but collection of instructions. There will be multiple instructions which are grouped together, and they are piled one after another in the memory. Don't worry about what memory I'm talking about. Don't worry about if it is RAM or ROM. I'm not going into that. You just understand that your code cannot hang in somewhere. It is in memory. And the program is nothing but series of instructions. Now, what will happen when you go with the computation, when you go with the computer architecture perspective of understanding how it works with respect to the program, is very important. First, fetch the instruction from the instruction memory. Now, you understand what is instruction memory. Instruction memory is nothing but where your instructions are stored. You see the right hand side now, I am highlighting it. This is the first step. You are fetching the instruction from instruction memory, which is nothing but your program memory. Now, the instruction is now available there. You have fetched it. Now, the next step for you to do is to decode the instruction. Yes, I will have to decode the instruction for a simple reason, that I need to understand what that instruction is all about. Decoding is to understand what is that instruction meant for. Now, the next step is I have decoded it. First, I have the instructions available in my memory. I have fetched one of the instructions, maybe the first instruction. I understood what that instruction is. Now, the next step is to identify and locate the operands. Add A comma B comma C, B and C to be added, and the result should go to A. Now I need to identify where this B and C are available. After the computation is performed, I need to store it in A. Where A is available, I need to understand this, and this is the next step. Now the very next step after it is, I have got A, B, C. I know what are all the operands. I know where to store the result. I know where the operands are available. So the next step is to go for the execution. I also have decoded what is that instruction. For example, if it is add, I have decoded that yes, it is an add instruction, and it is going to add two numbers together, and the result has to go to some register, and that's what we have decoded. So it's very simple. Now the execution can be done. Now the execution is done. The next step is to store the result into a register or a memory location based on your requirement. If it is load and store architecture, it is most certainly into a register where you can store the result first, and then you can move it to the memory location. Now, the program counter, we will have to load it with the next instruction's address, and once this is done, the sequence will continue as I have shown you in the diagram. So it is all about fetch, decode, and execute. Fetch the next instruction, then continue the cycle. This is called as instruction execution cycle, and it is such an important term for any engineer to understand before you go deeper into computer architecture. And now it's very important to also recollect some of the fundamental terms. One is program counter. Program counter is a register. Please understand, it is a register. It can hold some data. That data is nothing but the address of the subsequent instruction to be executed. What is the length of the program counter? It depends on the particular architecture that you are choosing. It can be 16-bit, it can be 32-bit, whatever architecture you are choosing, we will stay with that architecture's specification towards understanding the program counters with. Can I access program counter? No, most of the architectures does not permit you to access the program counter's content because we may change the flow. Next, stack and stack pointer. Stack is a temporary storage area. It is part of the memory, which is primary memory, which I am talking about. It is RAM's, a part of RAM, I could say. For a simple example, when you are calling a function, say add 3, 4 by passing 3 and 4 as arguments, the copy, call by value, call by reference, you must have heard. When I'm going with call by value, these values are copied and they'll be kept in the stack. And stack is like a ladder. I can store the content in the first, second, third, four, five steps in the ladder. And I need to have a pointer really to understand where I am right now. So that is called stack pointer. It is again a register. Its content is again an address. What is a bus? A bus is nothing but a channel, a medium, which can take the data from one end to another end. If it takes data, it is data bus. If it is taking address, it is address bus. If it is taking control signals, it is control bus. Now with this, I conclude this session. The next session is going to be pretty much interesting, I tell you. And we are getting into the core part of computer architecture with respect to MIPS in the next session. I'm looking forward to talk to you guys in the next session. If you have any questions, suggestions, inputs, appreciations, criticism, please go ahead and type it in the comment section. I'm looking forward to it. Thank you very much for following my channel. Thank you very much for the tremendous support that you guys are giving to me. Thank you.